Hello?
Bizarre. Collect call from...
Life of a Lifer.
To accept this call, press 5 now.
Hello and welcome, friends and family. I hope that your day is going well. Thanks for stopping by to support us here. This is Taylor from Behind the Walls and Fences, giving a voice from the inside. So today we have our film dude on the show, and he's a perfect example of the ordinary fellow who got a dose of what is happening and all the things that we are doing, and it opened up his mind. He's a very talented and dedicated individual, so please welcome Brian. Brian, do I got you on the phone?
Yes, you do. How you doing, Taylor?
I'm doing good. It's nice to have you with us.
I'm glad to be here.
So you were a part of the basically first in history candlelight vigil that was dedicated to the 1,300 men and women with sentences currently that are going to die in prison. And you basically captured all the footage of that and were able to go around and do some interviews. And I just want to get it from your perspective, the impact that it had on you and what you thought about what went on.
Yeah, we were talking about this event when it was coming up, and I think initially I went into it not easily. For whatever reason, I felt like I thought the justice system had a better checks and balances system in place, and realized when people that had been rehabilitated and people that were showing improvement were not let out, I didn't understand that that wasn't happening. I trusted that the criminal justice system that we had in place, if people were in jail, and still in jail, there was a reason for that. It wasn't because maybe they didn't pass certain psychological tests or they didn't pass certain benchmarks that show that they're improvement. I felt like that was already a given. And I think showing up at the event and starting to interview people and talking about stuff, I think I was blown away. This isn't happening. There's not a valid parole system, a solid parole system. I mean, what? That was my initial reaction to it. It's like, completely naive to the fact that this has been going on. And I feel like we're progressing along as a country and the technology and the things that we are able to do and learn, and how come our criminal system is so archaic. I couldn't wrap my head around it. I think I was just more surprised than anything else.
Wow, and this is coming from somebody who just had a general idea of what they thought it would be, just assumed, right? Is that what I'm hearing you saying? And upon further look into it, it opens your eyes a little bit as to what the reality of things are.
Yeah, the general public is not aware of the systems that are in place. And unless you are in trouble with the law, unless you are facing those kind of things, that's where you get exposed to how the system is in place. Like for me, I think the worst thing I ever, you know, when I was maybe about 15 years old, I got involved in smoking weed and got in trouble. At one point, got overnight in jail. Not even in jail. It was more like a detention thing. It wasn't even quite a jail cell. And even that, I didn't have any understanding. All I know is they slapped my wrist and headed me on my way. And I had no clue that there were people in there that were serving life sentences and were not going to be able to get out. I wasn't aware of that.
Yeah. It's a pretty heavy duty subject. It's something that is a conversation that we're trying to open up and make awareness to people like yourself and people that have no idea, or maybe there would be something different in place. It's like you got to see it to understand it. Otherwise, maybe people are going to think, oh, well, they're just a bunch of criminals. They're just trying to get out of prison. Of course, they're going to say that stuff. But when you actually look a little deeper.
You make a good point. If the general public does not know, I think that if this was brought up into trying to pass a bill and we're trying to get the general public to understand what's going on here, I think most people think, just like me, that the people that are in there, they did a crime and they're still in there for some sort of reason, right? We're unaware of the fact that there's not a solid rehabilitation program in place that not only rehabilitates and helps them get on course while they're in there, but that prepares them for when they get out. And I feel like it's the government just wants to stay out of sight, out of mind. But I feel like unless you're able to touch a lot of the people like me that are out there that are clueless, I think that the widespread adoption is what needs to happen in this place. There needs to be more of a broader awareness in the general public, not just in those that are personally affected, that family that have people in prison. It needs to be bigger than that. There needs to be more people supporting it that aren't even personally affected by it. People that are living their lives and unaware that so much of their money every day, every week, every year is going toward this prison system that is flawed. And we weren't aware that it was flawed. And why are we wasting our money on that? Why aren't we putting it into things that rehabilitate and get them back into society so they can contribute and they can be a part of society?
That is the biggest thing that would be a cause for the general public who doesn't necessarily have any ties to anybody that's in prison or has never dealt with it themselves is the money factor that you touched on there. So much of the tax dollars are going towards the system.
A lot of money.
A lot. And so they're constantly running out of money too, wanting more. And what is the purpose of that? To continue growing this incarcerated population, or are they trying to reduce it and trying to make people that come to prison, if they did get on that lifestyle, come to prison, and when they get out, they're going to not come back again, or they're not going to get a life sentence and then continue to grow that population of people that are going to be in here forever? Because it costs, I want to say, I saw the numbers, around $50,000 a year to house somebody in here. So if you look at that, it's getting up there close to 20,000 people, I believe, in Washington State that are incarcerated currently. You look at that and you say $50,000 a year for each of those people. Jeez Louise, that's a lot of money. And if it's not even going towards something that is going to, in the end, help people and reduce that amount of people that go back, but yet it keeps growing. What is the purpose of that? And why is there not something in place when we have all these scientists and psychologists and all these different programs that we know help and really work, and not to mention all the people who have rehabilitated? I'm a great example of somebody who's done a whole lot of different stuff throughout my time in the last 14 years incarcerated, yet I have a lifestyle possibility parole sentence. There is no option for me other than my own hope that I've created. Throughout the project that we've done, we made a magazine that reaches across America throughout the prisons to provide a platform to give people hope and saying, hey, do something better with your life and look at things that can happen for you. There is potential in a future here. Not to mention, like myself, that was stuck in that mentality of crime as a youth, who then at 20 years old got sentenced to life without the possibility of parole, has taken this time to better myself. It took me several years. It wasn't until I was about 26, 27 that it dawned on me and clicked, and I decided, I made a choice to do something different. And I've been working on that ever since.
Yeah. At the event, I think the Van C. Willard's name. And I was pretty impressed by him. I think he got out not terribly long time ago, but he's investing in the youth. He's teaching them all kinds of stuff, how to keep on course, how to better their life, and how to avoid the pitfalls that can get you into trouble. And what he's doing there, I was like, that's a huge case study. If there's some way to show a bunch of those case studies of people that have gotten out, that did a lot of time, but they got out, and now look at what they're doing. If that can be shown, not only to the general public, but to those that are in power that are able to make decisions, I think that helps weigh it. Like I was saying, it's like out of sight, out of mind. Like they're hoping that we'll build another jail, we'll make more room for them. It's such a archaic way of thinking. I think that they just have a hard time with change, I think, is part of it. And showing those case studies and showing those people that are actually doing it and that are out and making a difference, those are people, like, you can't take somebody that's never been to jail and have them try to teach kids that are in the inner city that are having trouble staying out of trouble. You can't, it has to be somebody that's gone through it. It has to be somebody that's faced those trials that is able to teach them effectively and relate with them. I think it's a huge amount of impact that people can have, given the opportunity to rehabilitate and change their lives and giving them a course for how they can get out of there, a game plan, and checks and balances of, hey, take care of these things over the next couple of years or over the next 5 years, and then we reevaluate and we say, okay, how are you doing now? Some structure, some really solid structure that allows them to have something to shoot for. Like you said, hope. That's huge.
Hope is a powerful thing. And if the ability to change is not going to come from the fear of trouble, and that's been proven over time, the fear of consequences is not where real change comes from. It never has. It never dissuaded me from doing anything that I've done in my life, the fear of the consequences. But what has empowered me to change is the actual, like, seeing and really experiencing opportunities of growth, and that something better is over here. The opportunity for the reward of something better, right? And being able to actually come from within, like you were saying, people that have been through this already, to show and guide the way and be there, because the real change is only going to come from within. It's not going to come from more consequences, tougher laws, more restrictions, and more enforcement on rules and punishments, higher punishments. Like, that does not work. Like you were saying, that's an archaic way of thinking. The way that real change actually comes about is by showing something different. I believe that the change has to come from within, and it has to be a reward system based off positive behaviors. I'm a dog trainer, right? That's something that I've been able to learn throughout being incarcerated. And I don't mean to compare people to dogs, but the behavioral is all based on psychology. So when you see it on that level, it all makes sense. And that's something that's helped me to gain a lot of perspective about it, is positive reinforcement. It's like, hey, you want the individual, or in this case, you wanted the dog that came from all different backgrounds of abuse. They come in and they have all these issues. So you want to change that behavior in them and teach them something new, something positive, right? Some better behaviors that you're looking for. Well, you don't sit there and scold them for the bad stuff that they're doing. That doesn't work. It's not effective. What you do is you show them something else to do and then reward them for that. And then they want to do that behavior. It's the same principle with teaching rehabilitation or finding actual correction to show us a better way to do things and then reward the people for doing that stuff. And pretty soon that's what they're going to want to do.
That's a good point. Again, I was completely naive. I felt like that's what was already in place. In the correctional facility that you're in right now, how many of those inmates do you think would be ready for a program like that?
I think that there's a lot. And there is, don't get me wrong, there is a lot of people that are not ready for that. However, at the same time, once it comes about and people catch on, it's like anything with change, a lot of times there's always going to be resistance to it on either side of the coin, right? On the people that are in the place to implement it, and on the people that are the ones that are going to be involved in it. It's going to be changed. But I think that there is a lot of people that are definitely ready for stuff like that. I deal with a lot of the people that are trying to better themselves and improve themselves. And most of these programs are voluntary by outside sponsors that come in, because the actual justice system does not provide a lot of that stuff. However, we have been able to create spaces and get their support on allowing us to do it on our own, basically. We have outside sponsors that come in and sponsor these type of programs. Also, a lot of them are led by inmates, because that's the best way to make an impact, is people who have been through it, not somebody that's trying to sit there and tell you what to do, but they don't really know nothing about it. We could provide a place for people like that to come back in to continue to show that pathway, and then, like you were saying, make the transition to getting out and what it looks like when you get out. So you have somebody who's experienced both sides. I think that is really the way in which this thing works. And hopefully people will start to see it.
Yeah, and be honest with you, these people that are out there doing stuff now, I don't feel it was because of the justice system preparing them as much as the passion that they got while they were in there to do good. If somebody's in there and they go through the hard work of changing the way they think and the way they act and learn new stuff and grow, I think it's a natural byproduct that they're going to come out and they're going to do good, and they're going to do better than a lot of the people that had never gone to jail, that are used to all these luxuries. And I feel like there'd be tons more case studies if they started to open up the possibility there. And one thing I was going to ask you, because I am curious about this, do you feel like the criminal system that's in place right now, do you think they have this thought that this could potentially open up the floodgates quote unquote, to let people out that shouldn't be let out. I thought I heard that a couple different times, and I don't see how that could be it. Can you touch on that or tell me a little bit more about that?
Yeah, I think that is definitely a fear that a lot of people have that aren't open to the ideas that we're talking about here, is that people would end up getting out and then causing harm again, which is a possibility. I understand that could potentially happen. However, look at all the people that are getting let out right now that have zero interest in getting out and doing good and all the harm that they're causing. Right. So if you look at that and you weigh it against the possibility of all these people who are doing good and want to get out and do good and impact change versus what you have going on right now.
Good point.
I would say that the only option is to make a change in that system. But with the parole system, it would have a lot of different things in place to ensure that, hey, this person is ready for that. It's not like they're going to let just anybody out. They got the Green River Killer that they always say, well, if we do that, then this guy will be able to get out. Well, no, that's not what it is. It means that people would have the opportunity to get out that have demonstrated these capacities.
And it's a case-by-case basis.
Exactly. It's not a one-size-fits-all. And the other thing is, in the current system that they have in place, they want to wait until your last year, till like 1 year before you're about to be released, before they provide you the majority of any of the programs that are
in
place. Right.
Too late.
By that point, people are just doing the program so they can get out, and they don't really give a shit. They're not interested in none of that. It doesn't make any sense.
You're totally right. If they're in there, for, in your case, serving a life sentence, you got all the time in the world. This can be a 5-year plan. It could be a 10-year plan. You start when they first get in there, and you go through a series of steps. Again, I was naive. I thought this was how they did it. But here we're spending all this money to keep people in jail instead of spending it toward rehabilitation and restoration. It doesn't make sense. I think this should be like a no-brainer. And again, it comes back to the fact that I think it's just ignorance. I think there's a lot of people out there like me that don't know what's going on. They don't know that this is not in place. They don't know that there's another way. They don't know where their money is going. And I think that bringing exposure to that in whatever means necessary, whatever it takes, get this out there to where they can see what's going on and understand it.
I think that the majority of people would agree with you if they understood, if it was laid out for them and they could see that is what the reality is. But like you said, most people just don't know, probably don't even care. So that's the way that it stays, the status quo. And I think that with what we're doing here, being able to spread the word about it, the more change, that actual change will be in effect. And I think things will begin to be seen a little differently.
Very true. Well said.
Brian, I appreciate you coming on here. I know you got your production company. What's the name of that?
Brian Gaber Films. Find it on briangaber.com or Instagram, Brian Gaber Films.
Phenomenal work they're doing. I've got to say that everybody who's checked it out has been highly impressed with the quality that you put out. I want to say thank you, Brian. And if anybody's out there that needs some film work done, Brian Gaber Films is where it's at. And this guy does top-notch work.
Keep it up, man. Keep up what you're doing in there. It's making a difference.
All right. Thanks for stopping by. Take care.
Take care. All right.
That was a cool interview. Thanks for joining in to Life of a Lifer. Don't forget to get on Instagram, A Life of a Lifer. Find us on Facebook. Go to lifeofalifer.com and subscribe. Thank you for listening. I'm Taylor Conley, and this is Life of a Lifer podcast. Be sure to visit the website lifeofalifer.com and don't forget to subscribe so you never miss an episode.